So what I want to do today is talk about the theory of competition. And when I use the word competition, I always preface it with the word real competition, because anybody who studied economics has a totally messed up sense of what the term competition means. And it's important to understand that beginning with Adam Smith and even before Smith, in the pre-classical and classical tradition, so that includes Smith, Ricardo, and then subsequently particularly Marx, but you have Mill and Malthus, they had an understanding of capitalism that was derived from the study of capitalism. And because it was derived from the study of capitalism, the notion of competition was that derived from the study of business behavior. But by the end of the 19th century, the class struggle between labor and capital was all central to economic analysis and political analysis. People had fastened on Ricardo's theory of prices, which said that at the first approximation, prices would be proportional to direct and indirect labor time, labor value in Marx's sense, and had begun to argue that if the product price was determined by the amount of labor that went into the commodity, directly and indirectly, then why should labor not get all of the commodity? That became part of the socialist, anti-capitalist argument that labor's product should belong to labor. And so therefore it became central to try to develop a vision of capitalism in which there was no such thing as exploitation and no such thing as conflict. And in order to do that, the economists who became the ones, not everybody did this, but the ones who got selected by the Darwinian process of social choice, social selection, were the ones who began to focus on exchange as the central characteristic of capitalism. Now, the thing about exchange is that on the surface, exchange is a sphere of equality. You can go into a shop. You don't have to go into the shop. You go to another shop. The shop doesn't have to sell to you. Well, now you do, unless you live in Tennessee or something. But you have to sell to your customer. Your customer can buy from you, can choose from any. So therefore, it's a sphere of equality on the surface. And that starting point makes central to the growing alternative vision, which focuses on exchange as the paradigmatic moment of capitalist society, a moment of essential equality, and builds from there the idea that what capital does is serve the customer by producing goods for the future or producing goods for the use of the customer. And the idea becomes then that capitalism is a system that is at the service of the customer. So the whole classical notion of class, of a ruling class of capital and capitalists and landlord and a subordinate class of labor and a peasantry before that, all of that gets replaced by the idea that in exchange anybody can be on either side. Samuelson, for instance, at one point talks about the fact that in general equilibrium theory and in neoclassical theory in general, it makes no difference whether you're a worker or a capitalist, it's just choice that you make. And you could something that's good for workers is good for capital, it's good for capital, it's good for workers also. That vision would not have been picked up had it not been for the changing politics. As the politics changed, and as it became this notion of capitalism as a servant of the consumer became increasingly prevalent. And any history of thought book will tell you that. But one of the consequences of that change was that the notion of competition got altered, fundamentally. And the notion that developed was a notion that was consistent with the broader vision, as my former colleague Bob Halbrenner, our eminent colleague in the department, Robert Halbrenner, used to say, this is in that vision of equality and service, the firm becomes a servant of the consumer, and therefore competition becomes a means by which the firm is made this servant. Now, how does that work? What are the assumptions of perfect competition? Well, first of all, we know that on the side of the customer, and I talked about this in the lecture about micro foundations, the customer is making choices entirely for himself or herself with no regard for any others, and every choice they make is aimed at increasing their satisfaction, and because they have perfect knowledge and everything else about knowledge of the future, knowledge of all options, they do make the right choice, and therefore every choice they make realizes their goal of increasing their satisfaction. You're all familiar with this. Indifference curves are your equi-satisfaction curves, iso-satisfaction curves, and your purpose is to move up to the highest curve that you can, and that highest curve is where your budget line is tangent to it. Your budget line is your constraint, and you seek to get the maximum satisfaction, and you do get it because, of course, you know exactly what you're doing. You're not influenced by any others because your utility is not affected by anyone else's, not affected by advertising, not affected by what's happening to your parents or your family, none of that. It's affected only by your selfish concern for things. Now, Marx calls this perfect representation of commodity fetishism. But you can see how powerful vision this is if you want to represent capitalism as an ideal system. So with this point of view, you begin with exchange, and everybody knows from those early models of exchange, the diagrams, Bowley-Box diagrams, where two consumers exchange with each other, and in their mutual exchange, each one gets better off. Now, interestingly, that same notion is applied to trade. So therefore, in international trade, you don't say that trade takes place by businesses trying to seek profits and getting the most out of them, as Adam Smith says, as Ricardo says, as Marx says. You say, instead, each nation can be viewed as a consumer, as a trader, and these two trades will not take place unless everybody is better off after them. So it follows that international trade also improves the satisfaction of a nation. The trouble with those things is that they have never worked empirically, but they work and they persist because they perform a powerful ideological function, which is to represent capitalism as an ideal system. But when this starting point, then the firm is brought into the picture as a means of roundabout getting to the commodities that you want in the present by producing the multiplicity of them, in the future by producing things, taking in capital now and producing output later. That vision then, in order to make it consistent with the story of exchange, requires you to make some assumptions about perfect competition, about competition. First one, every firm is alike. So in effect, there's only one firm. To put it another way, there's one firm with many names on it, but the names are irrelevant because there's only one firm. Secondly, each firm is very small relative to the market. Strictly speaking, each firm is infinitesimal, so that there's a large number of firms, very large. And the reason that assumption was brought in is because you want to abstract from the idea of demand. And you do this by saying that each firm is so small that it believes, a very important word, it believes that if it does something, it will have no impact on the market because it's too small. So that's the notion that gives you the idea that the demand curve for the firm in perfect competition is a horizontal line. Each firm believes it can produce as much as it wants at the going price, and that's another assumption. Each firm is a price taker. Firms don't set prices, they just do as they're told. They're given by the market. A price. So each firm is a price taker, and as a price taker, it seeks to maximize its own equivalent of satisfaction, which is, of course, the profit of a firm. So it maximizes its own profit subject to further assumptions about the shape of the cost curve, which we talked about in a previous lecture, and about the notion that it's optimizing, it has rational understanding and perfect knowledge of the present and the future and all of that. Now, this is familiar, I assume. Everybody here is a graduate student in economics. You've already taught it, usually, if you've been a TA, and you certainly suffered it for a long time. But I want to point out some of the characteristic features of this. Firms as price takers are demand indifferent because they assume that they can sell whatever they want. And that's what it means to take the price, and they concentrate on the quantity that they desire. It follows from there that they cannot be price setters, because that would be a violation of the assumption of perfect competition. So if I go in and I observe firms setting prices, I'll say, aha, imperfect competition. If I observe firms take into account other firms, I'd say imperfect competition. In fact, if I observe any firms at all, I will always end up saying imperfect competition because the construction is so bizarre that it does not survive any observation. And again, one has to ask, how can something last 130 years as the dominant paradigm if it is contradicted by the empirical evidence? The answer is because that's not the issue. It is providing a powerful foundation for the understanding of society. This is not different, in my opinion, in going to a religion that says such and such happened, God did this, and man came out of this, and Eve came out of Adam's rib, and all of that. And you go, but, I mean, look at the empirical evidence. Look at Darwin. And they don't say to you, oh, thank you very much. They say, how would you like to burn at the stake? And that's a choice that is because you're threatening not the facts, you're threatening the foundation. What is striking is that this vision replaced the earlier vision, which was in fact the one that was dominant in capitalism, with Adam Smith's vision of competition, Ricardo's, Marx's anti-capitalist vision, but still building on that classical foundation. So this vision of a harmonious, optimal, completely satisfying capitalism as the ultimate mode of production, this becomes dominant. While Ross provides a particular story about this, again, that story is well known, in which every customer sits down and types into the terminal, that's a modern version of the story, the offers that they have for things that they would like to buy, and offers for things that they would like to sell. These bids and offers are then tabulated by some central computer, which then says, okay, the market for apples is balanced, the market for cake is balanced, the market for warplanes is balanced, and when all the markets are fully balanced, the computer says to you, okay, you can now go ahead and trade. But notice in this process, trades only take place in general equilibrium. There's no such trade outside of general equilibrium. Now, again, this is a well-known feature of Walrasian mathematics, but also Walras's story. And so Walras is very important to read, to see this vision. But you can see here that the auctioneer, Walras's auctioneer, is the wizard behind the curtain who makes sure that everything works out right, and that, therefore, capitalism is essentially groping, as he puts it, tâtonnement, towards this perfect general equilibrium. That means every want is satisfied at some price, and every good is produced at some price, and those two prices have to coincide market by market. So that's all there is in general equilibrium. The math is pretty, it's nice, some of it is difficult, but there's nothing more in it than that. The whole point of this setup was to say that when we want to analyze what businesses actually do, we're left with this problem that in this framework that we have, we don't have any place to put that information because it appears as a deviation. And typically the literature, today's lecture is going to focus on the theory of real competition, how do businesses operate, and how this idea was developed by the classical economists and the empirical evidence. But next week, I'm going to focus much more on the empirical evidence. And we're going to come back again and again. I need to do that because in economics, the empirical evidence is seen as evidence of imperfection of competition. But it's only imperfection of perfect competition. It contradicts perfect competition. And the point I want to make is that it does not contradict the idea of real competition. Because that notion was not developed from talking about what would an optimal, ideal, efficient, and harmonious capitalism look like, but rather, what does capitalism look like? Adam Smith, for instance, everybody cites their CEOs and whole TED Talks built around Adam Smith's view of this and Adam Smith, also Jesus' view of this and Jesus' view of that. But anyway, the view. But people haven't read Adam Smith. Adam Smith says, don't trust the capitalists. The traders are always trying to get their advantage. Don't trust the landlords. They reap where they have never sown. The only group whose interests coincide with society is labor. This is Adam Smith talking. And yet that part doesn't show up. I need not say that Marx obviously has a much stronger vision of where the interests of society lie. But My point is here that I need to erase from your head the notion that competition is equivalent to perfect competition. And this is not just a notion in orthodoxy. It is the dominant notion in heterodoxy. The Monthly Review School, founded by Paul Sweezy, Harry Magdoff, Paul Baran, have their offices in New York City, have long had, have their own magazine. They're a Marxist organization, for a very prominent one, very politically active, very progressive. In a recent statement of their understanding of competition, they said competition is what Friedman says. It is perfect competition, it is this, and they say we oppose that because by opposing that notion of competition and saying that instead we have monopoly, we are basically opposing this vision of capitalism as perfect. I want to argue that that's a mistake, that's a trap. Because if you accept that definition of competition, then the only way you can deal with the real world is to say we don't have competition. And I want to show you that the evidence from business studies as well as empirical studies, which is what I'm going to focus on in the later part of this lecture and next week, is exactly the opposite. Businesses are subject to competition, and that competition shapes, channels, and ultimately produces outcomes that you're going to see recurrent outcomes over and over again, not as deviations from competition, but as representations of competition. So that's the first point. If I could erase a little, press a little button, and you could all forget that you'd ever heard the notion of competition, it would be a lot easier. But I know when I say it, you're going to translate it into perfect competition. And that, ironically, is more true on the left than it is on the right, because the left has built itself around the idea that it's monopoly and deviation from competition that accounts for the world. And I want to argue that it is not. What accounts for much of what we see is competition itself, but real competition. Is that point clear? Okay. So with that rant, let me start by talking about the issues, that the elements that build up the theory of real competition. The first point, which is very central and it's common to pretty much the classical economists, but comes out most clearly in Marx, is that the capital is a social form of wealth driven by the profit motive. So capital is not what you have in your closet, unless, of course, you're selling what you have in your closet for money and profit. But your household implements are not capital. Your car is not capital. Your computer is not capital. However, the car, household implements, and computer can be capital if you're happening to standing in Home Depot where there are things that they sell for profit. So it's not the thing. It's a social use of the thing that makes it capital. Very important point. I often make the same point in a different way. If I'm on the New York City subway and I see someone with a large machete, I'm going to pretty much move to another car if I can, or at least warn people, because it's highly unlikely that that person is in the car with the machete in order to chop down sugarcane. And so you want to move away because you think that machete is not a tool, but a weapon. Same thing for a gun. In the countryside, you may see a gun, and it may mean that the people are just, you know, shooting on their land. In the subway, you don't want to be in the car with the gun because the social relation holding it, not because of the thing itself. So the idea that capital is driven by the profit motive means also that it is inherently expansionary. This is a point that Marx makes, but it's also implicit in Smith and Ricardo. I put in money with the idea of getting more money. I get the more money if I'm lucky, if I survive, and what do I do with the more money? Of course, I have to put it back to get more money because the purpose of the circuit is to start with money and end up with more money so you can have more money put in and you can end up with more money. So in Marx's point, this is a spiral, upward spiral. The circuit MC, M prime, is a spiral in which you're driven to enter, re-enter, to come out again with more. Now, if that's true, and it's true of each one of you as individual capitals, then it means that your expansion, which is inherent in the notion of what you want to do, in the principle of what you do in capital, is conflictual because it brings you into conflict with other capitals. You don't just expand straight up, you also expand sideways, and sideways are the other people in your industry. And from one industry to another, their industry's capital moves there. So these mobilities of capital are lead to antagonisms. into conflict. So each individual capital operates under this imperative: expand or die, but expansion means try to kill some others. And therefore, sometimes individual capitals succeed, sometimes they fail, sometimes they just survive. This is real competition. The competition of capitals is antagonistic by nature. It's turbulent, like any warfare. And it is as different from perfect competition, from this harmonious, ideal, optimal process of moving towards the ideal outcome. It's as different from that as a war is different from a ballet. Ballet also has people moving around, some tactics and strategy and all that, but a war is not a ballet. I won't dwell on that. If you have never been to a war, perhaps you don't see, perhaps you haven't been to ballet either, but I think you get the idea that they are fundamentally different because their goal is different, not just because their tools are different. So if you think of that, then the key paradigm for competition, real competition, is that it is a form of warfare. It stems from the inherent antagonism of each against each, and it has characteristic results which are easily mapped into the rules of warfare. For instance, tactics, strategy, and evaluating your prospects for gaining territory. These are central concerns of the competitive firm in real competition, but they're also characteristic features of warfare. In this battle of real competition, mobility of capital from one terrain to another. You're selling a product and others want to try to break into your market, that's a mobility of capital, but that is a battle for terrain. The development, that's equivalent to the movement of armies from one terrain to another. The development and adoption of technology is equivalent to the arms race, because the technology is the means of lowering your costs, and the costs are the means of lowering your price, and your price is the weapon, is your cannon by which you knock down the walls. And the struggle for profit, market share, and growth and profit, of course, is the field of battle itself. That's fought locally, house by house, and market by market, commodity by commodity. From this point of view, the relevant profit, the profit that is of concern to firms, is a defensible profit. It's not just anything you can grab. It's what you can hang on to. Hang on one second. That you can hang on to. And I already made this point last time in the lecture about cost curves, that in the classical argument, and this is also true in business arguments, you want to operate at the lowest cost point on your cost curve, because that's the point that gives you the greatest advantage against your customer, your competitors. Your cost enables you to compete. Depending on if your costs are lower, you can lower your price and harm the others more than they can harm you. That's the whole point of warfare, by the way. Harming others more than they can harm you. And that cost advantage then determines a particular point on the cost curve, which, as I talked about last time, is essentially the lowest point except for some reserve capacity, which you want to keep. So what do firms do in this vision of real competition, in this notion of real competition? In the first place, they set prices with the idea, with an eye on the market and what their competitors will do. And when you think about it, the idea that firms set prices is so obvious that it comes as a shock that in orthodox economics, firms don't set prices. They take them as given. So who gives the price? Well, they say the market. But who's the market? The market is firms, and they don't set the price. The other side of the market is consumers, but they don't set the price either. They take the price. So neoclassical theory has a well-known hole in the donut of its theory, which is that nobody sets the price. And this is a point I've made before, that this is well-known within the theory, that there is no mechanism for price setting. You say the market. Walras at least has a story. He has an auctioneer. The only problem is there is no such thing as an auctioneer in most markets. So the auctioneer sets the price. But the auctioneer doesn't just set the price. He sets a price which is a general equilibrium price for the whole economy. But market by market, there is no story of the setting of price in perfect competition. In real competition, price is set by firms. They set the price, and they use the price to attract customers. They fight. So price is their weapon, and propaganda is their advertising. Advertising is their propaganda, the means of attracting customers, winning hearts and minds, as George Bush used to say before he lost all the hearts and minds. Now, from this point of view, if you have firms who are competing with each other, firms who can cut costs can get an advantage over other firms, and they can expand their market share. And that's a very well-established thing. I'm going to come back to the Harvard Business Review studies and all of that about how firms actually behave in markets. But cost-cutting is very central, because if you can lower your costs, you can lower your price. If you lower your price, you can hurt your competitor more than you hurt yourself. You do hurt yourself by doing that. But you can gain customers and make up for the lower price. And so you can expand market share. Well, then that leads to the question of how do you cut costs? Costs can be cut in two central ways. One is by reducing wages, or increasing the length and intensity of the working day. I spent a lot of time talking about the implications of the length and intensity of the working day. But notice that that pressure on every capital to defend its position is always one against others who might do it first. So there's always a pressure in every firm and every business to see if there's some way to cut costs. You can do it by revising the production conditions, but if you can lower wages or go to lower wage labor, then you can cut costs. That means that is imminent in the existence of the firm in real competition is a conflict between the success of the firm and the success of labor. Because the success of labor, which is higher wages, better working conditions, comes in conflict with the cost imperative of the firm, which is to lower costs and keep prices down.
But how do you argue that prices are set?
Hang on. Let me finish this point. So then the second point is technical change is the other side of that story. If you can cut your costs, not necessarily cut your unit labor costs, not necessarily by cutting wages, but by increasing productivity. One way is to make people work harder, but there are social and political limits to that at some point in capitalism. By the way, that's an important point. That limit hasn't come yet in China. And it isn't come in Vietnam, it hasn't come in Mexico, but it has come in the advanced capitalist world, so we sort of take it for granted. We forget how much blood went on the side of labor into achieving those conditions. But now there are certain restrictions. You cannot simply reduce wages. You cannot simply increase the length of the working day. But you can always restructure production and introduce new technology as soon as it becomes profitable. Technology is costly. You can't just jump to a new technology. But if the advantage is big enough, someone will do it. And if you don't do it first, they will do it unto you first. And so you get periods of quiet where firms sort of hang on, or they're lucky, nothing is much happening. And then you get these bursts where suddenly the technical change comes. The introduction of computers is a classic example of that. Introduction of robots is another classic example of that. And that's ongoing somewhere here, somewhere there, picked up from here or there. But it bubbles through, and you can see it when you step back and you look at the collectivity of firms and you look at over time. You see, one thing you see over time in capitalism, and there's the first set of pictures I tried to show you, you remember? Productivity rises steadily. Capitalism is a productivity increasing society. Why? Because it wants everybody to be happier? No, because increasing productivity lowers your costs. That's the main imperative at the level of the firm. It lowers your costs. Now, another point which is crucial in this understanding is that no firm is guaranteed profit. Something like 30% of firms fail in the first year, in good years. I'm not talking about bad years like 2007, 2008. 30% fail. And in 70% fail after the end of 5 years. And these, by the way, you can look up these statistics. They are on the BEA webpage. I can give you the citation. That means that when you start a business or when you operate a business, there's nobody there to guarantee you a profit. You have to get that from the market. And of course, everybody else is trying to take your share and your profit, so that, again, you not only just have to get it, you have to defend it. Even if firms are successful, profitable, they can incur losses for a long period of time. It's now a kind of joke that big companies can start off initially incurring losses, but because they're big enough to survive it, they hopefully get to the point where they will survive. But we forget that many don't. We talk about all these people who made $1 billion by sitting in their computer, in their classroom, dropping out of MIT or Caltech, and they sat down and they did this program and they're worth $1 billion. We don't talk about all the people who dropped out of MIT and Caltech and are now working at Starbucks because they didn't make it. So the idea that it's just a trivial thing is a popular fiction, but it is simply not supportable. For this reason, you cannot count profit as part of your cost. What does that mean, cost? Cost means that you are judging what you paid for things. I don't care what your costs are when I'm buying something. You can't come to me and say, look, my costs have gone up, so you're going to have to pay for it. You can raise your price, and someone else can choose not to, and I'll go somewhere else. So your cost is relevant to your pricing decision, but it's not relevant to me. I have no sympathy for it at all, no interest in it at all as a customer. So when we talk about cost, you can see why firms have understanding that cost is something they actually paid for, but you can't say that profit is part of your cost. Why do I bring that up? Because in the previous lecture, I mentioned, or the lecture before that, I mentioned that in orthodox economics, in neoclassical economics, normal profit is counted as part of your cost. Your cost curve, in your average fixed cost curve, is not just your depreciation cost per unit output, it's also your normal profit per unit output. And when you say, well, how did you build that into cost? They say, well, it's an opportunity cost. If I'm going to go business, I'm foregoing the normal rate of profit, so therefore I have to assume that that's my right, my guaranteed right. But that is a notion which you cannot find in any classical notion of cost, nor can you find it in business. Again, because the classical ideas are developed from the study of business. It doesn't follow, by the way, that the classical ideas are those that business people perceive. That's a different story. I mean, any more than if sociologists will study us as people doesn't mean that we're going to find they see us in the way that we see ourselves. But I'm going to come back to whether or not the classical notion is able to explain what businesses do rather than what businesses say they do. And those are not the same thing. For the same reason, it's equally improper to count interest as a part of operating cost. What is interest? Interest is money that you pay on a loan. You can't charge that as a cost because then you can say your costs are high because you borrowed a lot. Well, that just means if you borrowed a lot that your profit is going to be shared a lot between you and your lender. So that's a question of the division of profit, not of your cost. It is true, however, that the interest rate is a kind of benchmark, which is not the same thing as the interest that you pay on your actual loans. The interest rate can be a benchmark because if you are, as an active capitalist, not making more than what you would make if you put your money in the bank, then you're not doing very well as an active capitalist. So for that reason, all the classical economists counterpose the average profit rate made by capitals all over the nation or any unit, the average in an industry, to the interest rate. Because that tells you how well they're doing relative to passive use of capital. Because putting it in business is an active use. It has many more risks, many more failures also. And so the difference between the two is counted as a kind of measure of the success of capital. Now Marx calls this difference, which is the difference between the profit rate and the interest rate, profit of enterprise. So it plays a huge role in the macro dynamics. So we have R minus I is the profit rate of enterprise. It's a return to enterprising, to enterprise, meaning entrepreneurship or risk taking or whatever. That's in Marx. K Keynes uses exactly the same idea. It's the if excess of the interest of the marginal efficiency of capital over the interest rate. And he says this is what drives investment. And Marx says that is what drives investment. So these two, again, both of them coming from an understanding how businesses actually behave. The measure of the profit rate of enterprise is a measure of the degree of success of capital. And you can clearly see from that a logical argument, which is that if the difference disappears, the number of firms who are going to go out of business will rise. Because the smaller that difference, the more fragile the existence of growth and accumulation. And we're going to show this. I won't do it this semester, but next semester when we talk about the movements in the US economy, you will see that that plays a very central role in regulating investment and growth. But the point here is that that also regulates the mobility of capital between sectors and the existence of success within a sector, within an industry, because that measure tells you whether you should keep on going. Obviously, if you're persistently making less money than you could by holding in the bank, you're going to find a lot of business, not all, a higher number of businesses going out because they're basically doing worse than they could by not taking the risks and effort that they make. So we now come to what I want to call the two types of turbulent equalization. I keep saying the word turbulent because, again, I need to get in your head that the idea of equalization is not the same thing as equality. Equality is if two things, let's say this is an equilibrium and the price comes down and it gets there and it stays there. That's equality, that's equilibrium. Equalization is if the center of gravity is moving and this thing is moving around it. And that turbulent equalization, and I showed you some pictures in the first lecture, in the lecture on methodology, that's a different notion. And we're going to see this empirically. We're going to see the difference between equality and equalization, and between smooth equality and turbulent equalization. In the real world of actual business operations, you will only find turbulence. The question is, what's the law underneath the turbulence? And if you look for it, you will see it. So what types of equalization takes place? First is competition within an industry puts pressure on firms to offer similar prices for goods of similar quality. So you can compete through price, you can compete through quality. Those two are essentially means of attracting customers. A very common comparison of computers. I typically persuade myself to buy a new computer every 3 years or so on the grounds that mine needs to be upgraded. It's not really true necessarily, but generally everybody's pushed along. And what I do is I start reading the literature on comparisons. And now the comparisons are typically comparisons of quality and price. Obviously, you're getting a packet here which is better than the packet there, so it should cost more, but does it cost more enough to justify the quality? And those are judgments that consumers make, but also businesses make. And quality and price can be duplicated in almost every case, not entirely, but almost every case. So there are many people offering the same set of packages or some variants of those packages. So if we take a commodity of a given quality, then the central focus is on price. And that's what the classicals typically focus on. They say, let's assume we're talking about things of equivalent quality. Then competition forces you to keep your price within the bounds of your market. It does not mean that they're equal. Before high-speed Xerox printer, high-speed photocopy printers came, sometimes people like myself would have to run out to a local copy shop and get copies made. And that copy shop used to have a little machine, and they used to charge you $1 or $2 for a piece of paper to be copied. Now, of course, now we have printers who can do it. But in those days, so you think, well, okay, the price there is $2 or $1, and if I go to Staples, which started doing it later, in those days, maybe you paid 25 cents. So why am I paying 4 times as much. And the answer is because a local shop, I'm only doing two pages, and I'm willing to bear that cost. Whereas in Staples, I have to travel there, and I have to line up and all of that. But as soon as I start doing any bulk, then I'm going to Staples or something equivalent, because then the price becomes central. And then if you go across Staples and Office Max and all that, you see those prices are very narrow. So part of the range of prices is just simply because they're not competing with the same product. They're offering you high speed, rapid, multiple bulk things, and the other is just offering you something on a Saturday night when you forgot to do it and you need to, same thing for faxes, by the way. You can go to shops and they'll send you a fax for $1, $3 if it's abroad. But obviously you can do a fax from your computer for much lower nowadays. So that spread of prices does not mean, does not imply the absence of competition. It just means those are local pools, so to speak, which are not subject to the general law. As soon as you look at the big sets and you look at what businesses pay for, any high volume customer, you'll see these prices narrow down sharply, sharply. They're not equal, because they cover differences in quality too, differences in repair, differences in customer service. But it's quite striking is how close they are. And if you look at that distribution, then you'll see the distribution moves over time. Let's say the price of computers. If you plot them over time across main stores in New York City, you'll find that they're not equal for any particular brand. You will find that the more the internet comes about, the more pressure from Amazon and so on, these prices narrow. And you find that they all fall for a particular quality sharply over time. So I call this the law of correlated prices, not the law of one price. Because you can depart from the mean for local conditions, including transportation costs, the needs, the quantity, as well as information of consumers and so on. But it's quite striking how this distribution of prices narrows when pressure comes from other spheres, other sellers abroad, when you can ship things cheaply, and how it moves down as any particular quality of computers becomes cheaper, as it's produced more cheaply, and prices are cut, and so on. So that's the sense in which classical economists talk about the law of one price. They don't mean equality. They mean this correlation, this bunching that comes from the pressure from your customers. Now, that point is obvious. Even my local newspaper shop could not have afforded to charge $20 for a Xerox or $10 for a Xerox. But they know that if you are in a crisis and you need two pages, they can charge you $2. Or nowadays, they charge you 50 cents or 25 cents, whatever it is. That's the upper limit before you say, OK, to hell with it, I'll go somewhere else. Is that point clear? So when we talk about price competition, we do not mean equality. We mean a distribution with a central tendency and a dispersion which is compressed by competition and which may have tails. You can always charge $10 for Xerox, and perhaps you even get someone to buy one once in a while, but most of the time you won't have any customers. Now notice that an implication of this is that price equality brought about by competition is an unintended consequence. It is what I call emergent property number one. It's nobody's intention that prices be equalized. Everybody wants their price to be the highest for the given quantity. But it's because other people will undercut you that prices get compressed. And you may not even realize. You say, well, this is a reasonable price. Well, what makes it reasonable today? 5 years ago, it wasn't reasonable. And it's because if you'd make it higher today, it's not reasonable anymore. So you incorporate in your, as a price setter, you incorporate into your thinking how much you can get away with and what the costs are of being above others or below others, because there are also costs of being below. Your profits are less, for instance, per unit. So first issue, competition affirms within an industry. Let's say we're split into two industries. Here is the industry that produces corn, and this industry produces rice. Each one of you has competitors, and so there's a distribution of corn prices and a distribution of iron prices. What did I say? Iron, steel, whatever the other one is, metal prices. And those two will be different because they're different commodities, but they'll be equalized in the sense that as the costs go down in corn, that distribution will tend to drift down. And the cost may go up in steel, the distribution will drift up. So that is the law of price equalization in the classical sense. And it, as I said, this is an emergent property. It's a consequence of the interaction of the units among each other and not of the intention of the units. Now we call it emergent property. It used to be called dialectics or something like that. But anyway, this is, you get the point, right? Any questions about this? Now there's another important equalization, the second moment of competition, so to speak. The first moment is competition within an industry. So I'm looking here in the corn industry, and I see you are all fighting for market share, and your prices determine, among other things, your prices determine who buys from you. Then I look over here in the iron industry, and I see fighting for market share in iron, and the prices determine their degree of success or failure. But then I can also say that if the profit rate in the corn sector is higher than the profit rate in the iron sector, new investment is going to flow more rapidly into this sector than here because the chances of success are better. You can't guarantee anything. There's no guarantee. You can come in and you might wipe out, and if you'd stayed there, you'd have done fine. But the chances of success on average are definitely better where there is higher profits. And this is a well-established property. I'm going to read you something from the Harvard Business Review later about the studies that show this is a repeated thing. Where profit rates are higher, industries, the number of new entrants is 7 times higher. Well, why? It's not hardly surprising. If you have high profit rates, there's a chance of you making more profit. It's a gold rush. That's all it is. And that means, it doesn't mean capital moves from iron to corn. Because in a growing economy, capital is always entering. It just means that it enters faster here than it does here. And so capital investment accelerates in a sector with a higher profit rate, and it decelerates in a sector with a lower profit rate. Is that point clear?
Are you arguing that the rate of return on capital ultimately will...
I'm going to get there. So the implication of this is that acceleration in a sector increases the supply because increases capacity. The reason you're going there is to sell. So you're coming in, you're bringing in new supply. It doesn't have to be new firms, by the way. It can be the same firm taking advantage of the profit opportunities there. But the supply expands where profits are high, and the supply contracts where profit, supply accelerates where profits are high and decelerates where they're low relative to demand. The measure is always relative to demand. And that means capital will keep flowing in until it begins to overshoot demand. And that increasing supply will bring prices down. Prices down will bring profitability down in the high profit sector. Prices in the other sector, supply will be growing more slowly until it's growing more slowly than demand. And that will bring prices up. And so you get equalization of rates of return among new investments. Notice I use the phrase new investment. It's not among all firms, because some firms are old, some firms have used old technology, and some firms are protected from this. They have patents, and so for a while they're exempt. They quickly discover when the patents expire that they're not exempt any longer. But you can have pools and profit and pockets of protected profit, and you have pools of people whose profits are below. But the question is, new investment enters an industry because it is motivated by the potential profitability. You don't have to, but you put your money anyway, you can leave it in the bank. So new investment is motivated by the gap. And where the gap is bigger, new investment is faster. That's the fundamental micro foundation of Keynesian and classical macro. Now I'm going to come to the empirical evidence. I need to set it up because you see that this is a logical consequence of the argument about real competition. Again, how does profit rate get equalized? It's not the average profit rate. We're going to examine both average profit rate and the rate of return on new investment. It's going to be only the rate of return on new investment is subject to this equalization. What does equalization mean? It does not mean they'll become equal. It means they will fluctuate around a common center of gravity. Because, of course, the center of gravity, which is the average profit rate, and the economy as a whole is moving for various reasons, up or down. So we're now talking about individual industries moving around this central tendency, which is the average rate of return on new investment. This is Keynes's marginal efficiency of investment. This is Marx's rate of return on not average capital, but on investment. You can see how naturally, from just the logic of the argument, you arrive at this conclusion. And you arrive at this hypothesis. So then the question is, how do we address it? I'm going to build up to that, but you can see already we've got the two things. Price equalization within industry, which is turbulent and produces distribution. Profit rate equalization between industries, which is turbulent and produces distribution. How do we tell that it's actually happening? Well, if the profit rates are just turbulent but don't cross back and forth, then we know they're not equalizing. You have to look to see if they're equalizing over time. And that means the high becomes low and the low becomes high. If you don't have that switching, it's not equalizing. It's staying different. So you can have profit rates that differ but don't cross over. That's not equalization. That's just turbulence. If they cross back and forth in a turbulent way, that's turbulent equalization. So you notice that this notion of turbulent equalization is very different from the conventional notion of equilibrium as a state of rest. Pity the poor capitalists, they never get any rest. And so we're going to look at that empirical evidence from the point of view of how we distinguish turbulence from turbulent equalization. Last point. All of this comes about through flexibility of market price. If when capital has a high rate of return in corn and new investment flows in and it increases supply, if the market price doesn't fall relative to other prices, it's always relative to the average rate of inflation or whatever. If that doesn't fall, then the profit rate doesn't fall. So it's the flexibility of market prices which is the crucial variable here. And that implies that in the classical tradition, market prices are viewed as very flexible because the flexibility brings about the equalization of profit rates. But that flexibility is not the same thing as a neoclassical idea of price reflecting the scarcity of a good. You can think of it differently. The flexibility of prices here reflects the scarcity of profit, but not the scarcity of goods and not utility in the conventional sense, in the neoclassical sense. Is that point clear? Flexibility responds to the potential for profits. Where the profits are high, prices will be driven down. Where the profits are low, prices will be driven up. Why? Because high profits increase supply relative to demand, always relative to demand. And that's obvious because firms entering will keep on entering until their effect is to reduce the price, increase the supply relative to demand. And same thing contracting at the other end. So the relative to demand is crucial. And of course, when firms make these judgments anyway, locally, they may not be right, but they're not indifferent to the possibility of demand expanding or contracting. It makes a big difference. High profits in a declining industry are different than high profits in an increasing industry. And all firms make that decision when they choose to recommit to the industry, which is a form of new investment, by the way, or leave, which is a disinvestment. The next point, which is very important, if prices are equalized, let's say we're talking about roughly equal prices in this stochastic sense in corn, it doesn't follow that every producer of corn has the same technology. Because new plant and equipment is always coming in, and old ones are always being retired. And to assume that they're all the same is like saying that everybody in a population has to have only one age. It's impossible. There's always going to be a distribution. You're born young and you die old, and in between there'll be some distribution. That is also true of the vintages of technology. And since the vintages are vintages of different technologies, they're vintages of different costs. Even if other things are equal, new technologies tend to come in because they are lower cost. So you're going to get the distribution of costs. In the book, I spent quite a bit of time showing the cost curves of different firms and with different technologies. The work of Salter, for instance, very famous book. A young economist at Cambridge who did a very famous book, and then he died, Australian. He died very young, so nothing else in his work carried forward. His study of how vintages of production technology in an industry have different costs. I'm going to take that for granted here because I don't have time to pursue that, but the implication of it is the following. If new technologies have lower costs and old technologies have higher costs, roughly, but if they're forced to sell at the same price, then obviously the profit margins will be the highest on the new technologies and the lowest on the old technologies. In fact, that is how businesses decide whether you want to scrap something. When you cannot make any profit on it, you scrap it. So the profit margins always will have a distribution which is inversely correlated with costs. Low cost, high profit margin. Because the price is the same, your cost is low, that's your profit margin. Price is the same, your cost is higher, your profit margin is lower. Price is the same, your profit margin is even higher. That's an older vintage, your profit margin is lower. Your vintage gets to the point where its cost is equal to the price, you scrap. Now, these are not exact rules. There are tactical issues involved, but you can show this stochastically that as closer as you get, the closer you are to what's called the scrapping margin. Now, if that's so, then it means that equalization of prices within an industry, in corn, if everybody's selling at the same price but they have different costs, is a disequalization of profit rates and profit margins. Think about that. Suppose you take the contrary hypothesis. Everybody has different costs. Then in order for them to have the same profit margin, they must all sell at different prices because they must add the same margin to their costs, so their prices will be different. That means the oldest technology will have the highest price and the newest technology will have the lowest price if you all charge the same margin. But in fact, that implies that customers will simply buy from anybody just because you deserve a higher profit margin. But competition among firms towards customers means customers will flock to the lower price, and that'll force the older technologies to price down. Maybe not all the way down, because they know they're going to die anyway. So if they're going to go out of business, you might want to hang on until you close that plant down and open another one. But there'll be a correlation then between costs and profit margins, which is an inverse correlation. Now remember, this is a necessary consequence of competition in the face of vintages which come from technical change. So it's a necessary consequence of competition in the face of persistent technical change. If that's the case, then a further implication is that since newer technologies tend to be bigger in scale and more capital intensive, and we're going to look at the data on that, then we're going to find that there'll be a correlation between higher profit margin and higher capital intensity. Let me say that again. The newer capitals will be more capital intensive, so they'll have lower costs, and at any common price, they'll have a higher profit margin. So there'll be a positive correlation between profit margin and capital intensity. Now, that's from the theory of real competition, and that implies that that correlation is a necessary consequence of competition. What is the expectation in perfect competition for the relation between profit margin and capital intensity? What's the correlation? Pardon?
One time, the other one.
Well, think about that. Suppose I said this is a perfectly competitive market. What are the differences in your technology?
None.
You're exactly alike, right? It follows, therefore, that you all have the same cost structure. So if you have the same cost structure, your profit margins must all be the same. Hence, there is no correlation between your profit margins, which are zero, which are x plus or minus a random variable, and your capital intensity, which is also the same, and therefore y plus or minus a random variable. If you correlate the two, since they have fixed mean and they're random otherwise, is correlation zero. That means that the evidence of this positive correlation is a violation of the assumptions of perfect competition. And so typically this evidence is one of the central features brought together, put forward to say that competition doesn't exist. because we start from perfect competition. We never think of any other kind. And in perfect competition, there would be no correlation. We look, we find a correlation. It follows that competition doesn't exist. But my point is that it's a necessary consequence of real competition. And that's going to be central when one of the central issues when we look at the empirical evidence. Yeah. Yes, I didn't specify, and in fact, correlation applies to both, but generally speaking, it's K over Q, that is capital per unit output, because cost is usually measured per unit output too, so it's capital over output and cost per unit. I'm going to show you data on that. I have a data set, if I remember, 435,000 sample points, and we reduced it down to numbers of comparable variables, and you're going to see this correlation. And the point of this is to show you this inverse correlation or the disequalization of profit rates and profit margins that takes place if you have the same price. We have all the capitals are selling at a price of 100, right? They have different costs. The oldest one has a cost of 82, then 80, 78, 76. The profit per unit output, which is not necessarily their choice. I mean, if they sell at a common price and they have costs, this is what they get. Is the lowest for the highest cost, and it goes down to the highest for the lowest cost. Is that okay? Everybody see that? If you look at the capital per unit output, I've constructed it so that the capital intensity per unit output is rising as you get to more efficient, lower cost capitals. And we're going to look at the data on that later. So in that case, you can see that not only the profit margins are higher for more for lower cost capitals, capital intensity is higher for lower cost capital. Hence, there is a correlation between profit margin and capital intensity. And yet this follows from simply the existence that there's a birth and death process. In every industry, there are vintages. And there's never any moment where those vintages will disappear unless there is no technical change for 40 years. Any questions? And by the way, the same implication for profit rates, but they don't follow quite the same way because the relationship between profit rate and profit margin is that the profit rate is equal to the profit margin, which is here, profit per unit output, which is here, and capital per unit output. Profit per unit output divided by capital per unit output is profit per unit capital. And that's your profit rate. So it's
capital intensity over time. Is it a time turned in or not?
I'm interested only at a moment of time here. I'm going to get to the time movement later. So the point here is that I can now show that the same process which equalizes prices disequalizes profit margins and profit rates. And that's the central point. In other words, I would expect profit margins and profit rates within an industry to be unequal. Okay? Now that raises a question. If that's so, this inequality actually depends on the price. If, for instance, here we had the price is 100, everything else is unchanged. Now I lower the price to 89.5, and you notice something happens. The correlation, the profit margins remains the same because the cost structure is unchanged. I've lowered the price. They all have lower profit margins, but the spectrum is the same. The oldest technology has the lowest profit margin, and the newest technology is the highest profit margin. But the profit rates can change because the capital intensity is the way that it's set up. There's always a price at which I can cut the price. The lowest cost producer can cut the price so that they actually have the highest profit rate. And that can be easily derived. I'm going to skip over that. But it's pretty straightforward if you think about the fact that the profit rate is equal to a valuable thing, a piece of chalk that's actually big enough to write, is profit margin over capital intensity, and the profit margin, let's say it's
I don't want to do it. It's profit over capital. Let's just do this profit over capital. Profit is price minus cost times output, and capital is K. And so this is price minus cost, which is the unit profit, profit per unit output, divided by capital intensity.
Now, that means that you can always find, for any given cost structure and given capital intensity, a price that'll reverse the rankings of the profit rate. And you should be able to work that out pretty straightforward. You can draw a straight line and show the profit rate as a function of these two things, of price over the capital intensity and the cost to capital intensity ratio. It's just a straight line. So that's important because the idea that price cutting is a characteristic behavior of competitive firms implies that firms coming in with lower costs can give themselves the advantage even in the profit rate by lowering the price enough. In other words, they do more damage to their competitors than they do to themselves. And that's a message. You can obviously see if the price gets low enough, say to 82, then this first capital goes to a profit rate of zero because the cost is equal to cost. And the signaling mechanism of price cutting is already a signaling going, look, I know your costs are higher than mine, or I believe they are, and I'm going to bet, like you do in a poker game, I'm going to bet that I'm going to lower the price and you're going to go out before I do. And that's a message which businesses repeatedly say they get easily, quickly. And they take that message, they lower their own price to match, but not necessarily all the way. Because if they think they're going out of business, they'll lose customers by keeping a higher price, but those customers may not decay as fast as their profits will decay if they lower the price all the way. So there's a tactic and strategy involved in that. And again, that's well observed empirically. So now that comes to the central issue, which is that if we're talking about competition between industries, which one of these is going to be the location for new investment? If I have a common selling price, then these all have different profit rates. If I'm going to move my capital or new capital is going to be moved into this industry, which of these methods of production is going to be the feasible one, the choice one, if they're all reproducible? The first thing is they have to be all reproducible, because if I'm coming in, I have to be able to reproduce them. So let's suppose that these are all reproducible. Of the reproducible ones, which one am I going to choose? The one with the lowest cost. And for the reason, because the lowest cost one can always cut prices to make itself the most profitable one. So it's the most defensible profit. And notice the parallel again to a warfare. It's the most defensible profit. It's the one which does the greatest harm to others. And that implies that there's a set of capitals, let's say C and D roughly, which are the ones that are the target of interest, of opportunity for new capitals coming in. And they're the ones which are going to expand. If this profit rate is higher than other industries, let's say the industry profit rate on average, other industries were 10%, and here you're making 15 to 16%, then capital is going to flow into this industry, it's going to drive up supply, it's going to drive down the price, and the profit rate will come down, and that's the turbulent equalization. But where is the price going to be set? Is going to be set in the industries in the firms with the lowest cost or technologies with the lowest cost, because those are the ones that can expand and have the most defensible cost structure. So these are what I'm going to call the regulating capitals. They're the technologies whose price is the subject of equalization of profit rates. And therefore, these are the ones whose price of production will become the one that regulates the market price. They'll become the regulators of market price. To switch it into modern terminology, they will be the price leaders in competition, because the mobility of capital from one sector to another will select them as the source of the new investment. Select that technology, not the firm, that technology as new investment. So that's interesting, because you notice that these lower cost firms or lower cost technologies are also the more capital intensive technologies. So you will find a typical expectation that the price leaders will be the biggest ones, the biggest amount of capital. Here, you see the capital stock. the more capital intensive ones. Not always, because new technologies can start small and expand, but in established technologies, you'll find that correlation is very strong. They're bigger, they're more capital intensive, and they're lower cost. And yet, that is a necessary consequence of competition. It's not a proof of absence of competition, it's a proof of the presence of competition. I want to talk about three different cost structures. These are labeled wrong in the book. This is A. I picked up the wrong graph, but anyway, think of it as industry A, or in which the firms are basically all alike. I draw it as a box to indicate they're not exactly alike. There's a distribution, but they are similar enough that you can say the average is where you'd expect to come. So in an industry like this where firms are alike, you can keep on adding more technologies of that same sort, and that's what the dotted line is telling you. So this is the regulating capital in a sector where the technologies are roughly the same. Usually that's the case in a new technology before others start to leapfrog and so on. But you can also have industries, and this should be B1, B2, B3, in which you have a structure, the squareness of the box indicates that the center line is just the mean of a distribution of technologies, which are roughly similar but don't operate at exactly the same cost. And different people operating the same machines may have different costs, different workers, different local conditions. So there is a kind of range. And then, but there is another set which is higher and another set which is still higher. And the question is, which one is the one chosen? If all of these are available, but this set is able to satisfy the demand, then the first set is the one chosen. But if demand rises, then the second set will be chosen because the first set is limited in its structure. And if demand rises sufficiently, the third set. So the cost or price of production will rise as you move this way, and this is Ricardo's theory of land. Ricardo's point is that if you have good lands when the nation is small, and then all those lands of a particular quality will determine the cost and price of production. But as a nation grows, it will have to move out to less good lands, and then this one will become the regulating price of production, and as it moves further, then the last one will become. So at any moment of time, there is a margin of production. The margin is not the same sense of the word marginal, because it doesn't involve any changes on the margin. When you move from one to the other, you leap to a new quality. I mean, think of it this way. Land near a town, good quality, it's near the river, and you use all of it. But as a town builds up, then you're just going to have to build up a hill to try to get land for planting. It's further away, it's more expensive, but since you've used up all that good land, that land will be feasible if its normal profit price, its price of production, can sell in the market. So the market will have to use up the good land, and the market price will rise. As the market price rises, then at some point, the next quality of land will come into use, and that will regulate for a considerable length of time. So these don't involve tiny fractions. They're moving up plateaus. That's a better way to think, moving up shelves. Now, this is different lands. I'm going to come to the technology next. This is different lands. So let me now move to the other case, which is the opposite case, in which, and the labels didn't show up. I'll fix all this up before I send it for the video. But this should be C1, C2, C3. And here, the cost structure of an older set of capitals, of a middle-aged set of capitals, and a new set of capitals. And you can see that if you're going to enter the industry, you're going to enter here, not here and here, right? And so these become the regulating capitals. And that's because the new technology, all of the technologies can be reproduced, but who would want to reproduce a technology that's 40 years old, or a technology that's 20 years old, when you can produce a technology which is 5 years old or recent? So the notion of a regulating capital brings in it with it the idea of the possibilities of reproducing conditions. If you cannot reproduce the quality of land, then even if you have good technology in all three lands, the land that is better situated or cheaper in cost, better fertilized, better irrigated, that land will be cheaper to produce. So you want to, that'll be the first land of use, but you may need lands of higher quality to fulfill the market demand, and therefore the regulating price will be that land at the top. Here, it'll be the technology with the lowest cost, so it'll be, so to speak, at the bottom of cost structure. Now, these are elementary things that appear in Ricardo, and in Marx, and in Mill, and in Malthus, but they do not appear in orthodox economics because it doesn't talk about these things as shelves. It talks about them as a kind of smooth curve in which every movement is a marginal incremental movement. But these are not. These are movements of one plateau to another. So these are the varieties of regulating capitals. In the first instance, the regulating capital will be the average, which is that one. In the second instance, the regulating capital will be the highest cost. And in the third instance, the regulating capital will be the lowest cost. Now, all of these are determined by their local structure, so to speak, industry structure, agricultural land distribution, and so on, so that it's not arbitrary. But these three types encompass three different expectations. So with this in mind, I want to talk about how to represent the idea of competition as a process and as an average result. And to do this, I want to remind you what I've been arguing all along. Consider the effects of profit rate competition. We have a set of industries, industry one, industry two, industry three. Industry one has an average profit rate up here. Industry two has an average profit rate here, and industry three has an average profit rate here. And this is before competition, so to speak. This is our starting point, right? What competition does, I said before these were average, but these are actually meant to be the regulating capital. Here's the average. We have then a set of regulating capitals, and the regulating capitals are not the same as the average. In the first type of industry, the regulating ones were the average. That's the one with only one type of technology, right? In the second type, which is agriculture, the regulating ones with the lowest profit rates because they're the ones on the highest cost land that you have to use in order to supply the product. And the third is the ones with the highest profit rate because these are the ones with the lowest cost, not highest cost, but lowest cost, highest profit margin, and possibly the highest profit rate. So what competition does will equalize the regulating conditions, the profit rate on the regulating conditions. Everybody understand the logic of this? If I was better at graphics, then I would show this, you know, and move over time and all that. I was hoping that one of you will do it at some point. But this is the best I could do. And anyway, in a book, you can't have it moving. So do you see the point, though? You'll see that if it equalizes the regulating rates, then the average rates will not be equalized. Because the averages reflect different ages and different conditions of agriculture and industry and all of that. And that's quite different. So now you can see what happens if we talk about equalization. You see that? You have one sector's, which is this sector's, regulating capital going up and down, and another sector's regulating capital, which is the lower one, not the top one, going down and up, and you get inequalization. So the equalization is an equalization of the regulating capital, but it'll carry the whole spectrum with it. And so therefore, we can say some things about the result of this equalization. I need two more things. Equalization of regulating capitals will not necessarily equalize national profit rates. If I have equalization of regulating capitals roughly here, and industries are not evenly distributed across nations, then it's possible that one nation will have all the high profit rates and another one lower, and that's perfectly consistent with international competition. This is an important point because many people sort of look at national profit rates and say, well, there's no international competition because these countries don't have the same profit rate. There's no expectation that they would. You'd have to look at their regulating capitals, which I'm going to do, but next week, apparently. Okay. Let me stop here because I can't proceed any further. I've run out of time. I'm going to pick up the issue here, which is to build up further, and we're going to look at the empirical evidence. We have a lot of empirical evidence, and I'm going to show you how it relates to theories of imperfect competition and why I don't believe in those theories. Okay, thanks.